you got on my 40, I got bread, but I wanna spend red money. Right. Fuck y'all.
Can't believe what the hell is going on. These rookies say they repping the A, but they doing it wrong. Let us show you how to do
ODs, it. And we came to rob the spot like Iron Man starts. They be the illest MCs in the world today. Cabaret, Quan, and the RZA. Listen to them clear and put the box right near your ear. Light your blunts and down your beers, cause you can never fuck with Wu-Tang Killer Bees.
Yeah! Let's go, Stewies!
Say peace to cats who rock Mac, knowledge, street astrologers, light up the mic, guard knobs, there's fly joints, the character points, Corolla, Motorola, holer, player guard, he pack over the shoulder, chrome tanks, player like Yanks, check the franchise, front on my guys, my enterprise, flash many lives, propeller fakes like reflectors, he has sugar in his ear in his last crack career, we can can him, manhandle him, if you wanna, run in his cribbo, get ditto, skate like a limo, and jet to the fly's estate, relate, take a break, break down the ape and then wait, drop it like Drake. Thugs, they be bowing and screwing. We canoe and claim they doing the same shit we doing. Fuck the union, it's the same style as the training.
It is hour number two of the Doug Stewart Show. Just like that. Just like that. We already in hour number two of the Doug Stewart Show. Thank you so much for joining your boy. Don't forget at 1 p.m. Bring that back one in. Bring it back.
Can't count crazily grins, provide plans, laying with my bitches and my mans and Lex Lands. We losing them. Jet to the stash and now Jerusalem. Abusing them. Rocking his jewels like we using them. Low pro star. Seven thick waves. Rock polar. Roll with the older guard. Bill with the sun and the star.
Yes, sir. Oh, man. You cats had long verses, too. Like, they didn't have no little quick short verses. What did they call them, bars? They didn't do, like, one or two bars. Then they just used to do, like, 40, 50, 60 bars. Yeah. They used to do many, many, many bars. The Wu-Tang Clan, today we're paying tribute to the great Wu-Tang Clan. They have introduced and launched the careers of a number of affiliated artists and groups, often collectively known as Wu-Tang Killer Bees, and has been mentioned to be one of the most influential hip-hop groups of all time. In 2008, About.com ranked them the number one greatest hip-hop group of all times. I don't know who the hell About.com is, but I don't know about that. I don't know about that. Now, what do they classify as a group? Because I would think, if you're talking about hip-hop, and y'all correct me if I'm wrong, and y'all give me another name, I would think you talk about the greatest hip-hop group of all time, I would think that would be Public Enemy. Am I wrong about that? And even if you're talking about, I don't know if you would even classify Run DMC as a group, or is that another category? Is that a duo? And really, when you think about it, Public Enemy, it ain't a bunch of rappers. It's not a group of rappers. It's Public Enemy is a bunch of guys, you know, the S1Ws and Flavor Flav, but there's only one rapper. So maybe if they're talking about more than one, being Public Enemy and Chuck D, or more than a duo, meaning Run DMC, you know, as a duo with Run DMC, then maybe I understand. Maybe that's what they're saying. And if that's the case, yeah, that's they're talking about more than two. You know, one is a single rapper, really, even though it's a bunch of guys in Public Enemy. Two is a duo and Run DMC. If they're talking about more than two guys, You know, they would definitely qualify for that because they got nine dudes or started out with nine dudes. Rest in peace, Old Dirty Bastard. If you're talking about more than two dudes, yeah, I think I can go with that. Wu-Tang Clan. I think so. I think so. But we're paying homage to Wu-Tang Clan today on the show. Don't forget, at 1 p.m. Eastern Time today, right here on the Stewart Media and Entertainment Network, my man Jeff Fox with the Jeff Fox Show at 1 p.m. Eastern. Following him at 2 p.m. Eastern today, Patty Cake Microwave. John Fisher's cooking with the microwave right here on SME. Pass the word. But man, Sidney Jackson says, he says, nah, Big L, I'm from the South. I listen to all this stuff, even the solo albums. Somebody said they wanted to see Clay Tax Time, Fool Davis. He says, I would love an Outkast tribute, Doug. We've already done Outkast. Once again, it's what, 52 weeks in a year? We've been doing this show over 2 years. So just from that math alone, you got 104 months. Or weeks. Then we've gone into 2017 by like 5 months or whatever. So we pretty much done everybody. I don't think we've ever done Wu-Tang before. We try to skip around. Maybe it's time to circle back around and pay tribute to Outkast. I don't have a problem with that. Love Outkast. And I just thought about it. So Outkast is another group. But is that a duo as well? I need to ask my man Kesey his thoughts on this. He's kind of like the music historian here on the Stewart Media and Entertainment Network. So Outkast is Dre and Big Boy. That's a duo as well. That's not necessarily a group. I need to try to find that list from About.com and how they categorize these groups, as they had Wu-Tang Clan as the number one group of all time. Listen, I understand. I see a lot of people in the chat group like they don't get Wu-Tang. They didn't like Wu-Tang. And Big Apple Bastard, who amazingly sounds a little bit like Jungle Brother. Big Apple Bastard summed it up perfectly, man. Wu-Tang ain't for everybody. Wu-Tang Clan is an acquired taste, I think. So, and we're going to get to the sports here in a second. Here's the thing that I remembered about Wu-Tang Clan when they came out. So they came out like 95. When did Bad Boy come out? And I'll tell you where I'm going with this in a second. You're listening to the Doug Stewart Show. A quick little search of Bad Boy Records. So Bad Boy was really going in 1993. So Bad Boy really hit 1993. I guess that's Craig Mack's Flavor in Your Air came out in 1993. Yeah, I remember that. So 93 is the year I graduated college, and I remember Bad Boy just hitting with that Craig Mack single, Flavor in Your Ear. So Wu-Tang came out in 1992. So maybe they didn't make it big till after. But I remember there being this conversation about, you know, Puffy and Bad Boy kind of really commercialized hip-hop. And, you know, Puffy with the shiny suits. And, like, they were so big. I mean, Bad Boy was so big. It's a little history lesson for you greenhorns. Bad Boy was orca big. Okay? Bad Boy was orca. Orca is the name of a movie with a big-ass whale. Bad Boy was orca big. And they had Mace. And they had Puffy. And they had shiny suits. And a lot of people question their skills. You think people question these lame rappers today? It was kind of like that conversation around Bad Boy outside of Biggie. You know, outside of Biggie. Biggie was clearly a supreme lyricist. But, you know, Puffy kind of made it commercial. And a lot of old school hip-hop purists didn't like the direction. You know, tell me if I'm wrong. If I'm off base here, you old school hip-hop fans. And a lot of hip-hop purists didn't like the direction that hip-hop was taking during the Bad Boy era. And then Wu-Tang got big, and Wu-Tang was all about lyrics. Yeah. Right. Like Wu-Tang, their beats, once again, we talked about the beats by the RZA. RZA's beats were very simple if you listen to them. They were very strange also, in my opinion. But RZA's beats weren't real complex. They didn't use samples. That was another thing. I think that's part of the reason why I thought about this as well, is that all of their beats were original beats. Even though they were strange and they were very simple, it's like they used a drum machine or something like that, they didn't use a lot of samples. That's what it was. And so Bad Boy, that's all Puffy did was use samples. Like, all of the music pretty much that Bad Boy and Puffy used during that time were all samples. And, oh, man, that was a big thing. Streets didn't like that. He was using all these samples, which is crazy because hip-hop was founded on using samples. But I think Puffy just took it a step too far. And hip-hop purists didn't like it. And then Wu-Tang came along, and they didn't use really no samples at all. And they were straight lyricists, you know. So it was kind of like a breath of fresh air for what Bad Boy had been doing for a minute, man. And that's why Wu-Tang had so many fans and has such a big brand and such a big presence. Yeah. Shots out. Tribute Tuesday. Wu-Tang Clan. Yeah, good times, man, good times. I remember when Wu came along. Once again, I moved to Atlanta, and they were really out there. That Cream track, I think, was out there. The Wu-Tang Clan, the Mystery of Chess Boxing, all of that stuff, man, was out during the mid-90s. So basically, the order was Bad Boy, talking about record labels. It was Bad Boy first, or was it? Death Row first. Was it Death Row first? No, it had to be Bad Boy. Had to be Bad Boy. Then Death Row shortly after them. Took it to the West Coast. Then Master P and them cats, No Limit Soldiers, No Limit Records came along like the late 90s or whatever, like 97, 98 or whatever. And they dominated. No Limit Records dominated for a couple of years too. Like each of these record labels, they had like a 2-3-4 year span where they were on top. And I mean, they were running everything. I mean, it was a great era. It was a great era of music, man. A very memorable time in the 90s, man. Early 90s with Bad Boy, mid 90s. Not too far behind Bad Boy. You had Death Row Records with Dr. Dre, Suge Knight, and Snoop, and Tupac, and all of them cats. Then the late 90s, Master P came along with basically his whole entire block from New Orleans. I mean, his whole block. Master P and them had a roster of about 40, 50 ninjas. Yeah. My man Dobby says nobody was pushing records out like No Limit. No. Oh, no. Master P should be credited, man, for his marketing skills. Like, Master P took cross-promotion to the next level. All right? For you greenhorns, people that don't remember that time, man, No Limit Records literally would put out a record probably every 2 weeks from a different artist. And and this was CDs back during this time, within that CD cover, they were promoting the next 10 albums. Like, they promote like a big picture and some details about the next album that was coming out, but they had already in the hopper the next 10 albums over the next 6 months that they were going to put out. Master P was pushing that weight on CD. Don't front. Don't front. Don't front. Loose Neck Size says No Limit album artwork had me buying albums too. Yeah. So they had that real kind of nice graphics that they had. They kind of took graphics and CD covers to a new level, but it all kind of fit within the framework of the No Limit Records brand. And so, like, they have this different, album covers, man, that were cool, sleek, you know. Graphic art really became a big thing, I guess, during that time of music or whatever, man. And Master P was at the forefront of all of that shit. You can say all you want about Master P. Master P was a businessman, a hustler. Yeah. T-Dub in the chat room says, mixing R&B with rap was smart, so you can't bash rappers for changing the game.